Hi friends, today I'm here to kick off another weekly reading vlog, and today I come to you with a purpose because this week I'm trying to read down my library holds. I like to think I use my library very responsibly. 9 times out of 10, my library holds are not disrupting my current reading plans because I mostly use the digital catalog to check out audiobooks or ebooks that I plan to read next anyways, and a lot of times those holds are instantaneous. And this is one of those times when I put a hold on a couple of new books my library branch had on order, thinking to myself that those holds could take up to 3 or 4 months to process, you know, like they usually do. But they both came through, and they both came through at the same time, because of course they did. Not to mention that I currently have an audiobook checked out from the digital catalog as well. So that's 3 library books I currently have checked out that I very much want to read. So I figured, let's just go for it. Let's just see how many of these, if not all of them, fingers crossed, I can get read this week. Let's just get into it. Here's what I'm working with. I'm gonna start with Organ Meats by Kaiming Chung. You might be looking at this and thinking, babe, that's not a library book. You're absolutely right. Great powers of observation. This is in fact a finished copy that was gifted to me by Penguin Random House, I believe as part of a Queer History Month mailing they sent me back in October. But I do have the audiobook for this one currently checked out. I'm actually about halfway through at the moment and absolutely McLovin' it. Let's back up for a second. This is categorically weird fiction, weird with a capital W as one would capitalize a proper noun. It's queer, it's surrealist, there's dream magic, it's really blowing my mind. Boiled down to its most essential parts, the story is about 2 childhood friends, Anita and Rainey, who tie matching red strings around their necks and make a pact to become dogs. They establish this whole mythos about being descended from dog-headed women and women-headed dogs, and it becomes this whole thing. And especially as Anita is realizing that Rainey's family is getting ready to move, she becomes more obsessed with solidifying their 2-girl dog pack. I don't want to spend too much time here, I do have at least 2 other books to introduce, but I am loving this. It's so unsettling, it's so bizarre, it's so sideways, but I absolutely love how the story is being told. It's a dual narrated audiobook as well, which is really great because you really get a sense of both characters' voices. The whole thing is very dreamlike. I don't have a better word to describe it right now. You can definitely call to mind that image of a thread mentioned in the synopsis because the narration itself feels like a gradual unraveling in a sense. The narrative follows its own unique logic, its dream logic, like I said. There's an ebb and a flow to it, and you have to surrender to that flow, that cadence, in order to fully appreciate what the story is doing. This is so fucking nerdy of me to say, and I hate that I'm gonna say it, but I am gonna say it. I keep thinking of that scene from Inception when Cobb is teaching Ariadne about shared dreaming, and he says that when you realize you're in a dream, you can't explain how you got to whatever's happening in the dream. There is no beginning, there is no end. There only is what is. And that's how this book feels. And let me tell you, it is messy. There's obsession to it, there's desperation to it. Ultimately, it's about this deep-seated craving for loyalty and belonging that we all have buried deep within us, and what happens when that desperation claws its way to the surface. It's fantastic. It is definitely doing something for me, for sure. I want to say that never in my life have I read this kind of prose that manages to be both narrative and poetic at the same time. The imagery, the language, the emotion feels borderline prose poetry in a way I can't really explain, and I love it. So I'm really eager to continue on with this. It's super short, so I honestly don't even think it's a question of if I'm gonna finish it or not. I think I will easily be able to finish this week. Like I said, these next 2 are fairly new releases. First, I have Behind You is the Sea by Susan Moadi Daraj. This is written by a Palestinian-American author. From what I understand, it's a novel that's sort of composed of interconnected stories. We're following residents of a Palestinian-American community in Baltimore and seeing how their their lives intersect, especially with three main families who are all immigrant families and who have had very different experiences coming to the States. I was definitely anticipating this one before it came out, so I'm really glad my library was able to get a copy, and I can't wait to dive in and see what it's all about. Lastly, I have a little bit of a wild card that I don't think many people might have heard about, and that is The Curse of Pietro Houdini by Derek B. Miller. This is historical fiction. I believe it's set in Italy. The tagline calls it an art heist adventure tale where enemies become heroes, allies become villains, and a child learns what it means to become an adult. This one is like my stretch goal for the week. I know I'm gonna finish Organ Meats. I feel like getting through Behind You is the Sea is very possible because it's also super short. This one, I'm just gonna see how far I get. Maybe I finish it, maybe I don't, but either way, it will at least be started. So that's what I'm working with for this week. I do have a few content-related things to do right now, but after that, I will have the rest of the evening to read and relax. So if you want to hear what I think of these books, stick around. Hi friends, it's currently Tuesday afternoon-ish. I'm on a lunch break right now. Not too much to report so far, but I did want to check in and give a quick update. Last night I listened to about an hour more of Organ Meats. Still super weird, still absolutely loving the entire reading process. I have about 2.5 hours left in the audiobook, but I'm also listening to it at like 1.2 times speed, I think, so I could very well finish this today. Something I forgot to mention yesterday in regards to the writing is that it works so incredibly well because on the one hand, it's whimsical, it's absurdist, it's almost childlike, it's weaving this dream logic that follows its own rules, but it's presented in a way that's very matter-of-fact, very self-assured, so it still feels grounded and balanced even though it's going to some really bizarre places. The other thing I love is that the writing is anything but predictable or formulaic. It's expansive, it's completely untethered from what we expect a quote-unquote traditional narrative to be doing or the way we expect a traditional narrative to perform. It's so hard to explain, but the way the sentences almost slip past one another as opposed to necessarily building on each other is so strangely captivating. Like, you can never predict where the next sentence is gonna take you, and rather than finding that jarring or off-putting, it makes me want to lean in closer and want to know more. I want to know everything. That kind of goes back to what I was saying yesterday about surrendering to the non-linear logic of the story as opposed to fighting against it or trying to prescribe how the story should fit into a box, because it can't and it doesn't. So this is pretty much my big project for the rest of the day. I have a pretty big stretch of free time after work. I also have the place to myself, so it's nice and quiet. I can read without any distraction, so that's gonna be great. And I just feel like if I really commit, if I really go for it, I could absolutely finish this. I did very briefly start Behind You is the Sea on a short break I had earlier today. I'm literally only 10 pages into it right now, so I really don't have much to discuss at this point. The first perspective in the story is really interesting to read from so far. It's from the point of view of a young girl whose father is ill, and she's also dealing with a teenage pregnancy, it seems. It's very voicey so far. She definitely has a strong personality and strong opinions about deviating from her traditional cultural norms, so we'll see where that goes. Finishing Organ Meats would also theoretically free me up to see if there's an audiobook edition of this book that I can access so I can do a hybrid read with it, because I can never read more than one audiobook at a time. But I could also very well just continue reading this physically, so we'll have to see what happens. Super short update, like I said, but hopefully you'll get to hear some final thoughts on at least one of my current reads very soon. Perhaps even right now. New room for new thoughts, because I did finish Organ Meats, and oh boy, Z, what an experience it was. I don't have to say this, but I'm gonna say it anyways. If you're looking for my complete, coherent thoughts on this book, that is not what you're going to get here in this moment. I'm still very much in the processing stage. That said, I love this. I said that in the very beginning, I'm still saying it right now. Even though this book isn't gonna be for everyone, it was 100% for me. It's so fucking weird, and I say that as the absolute highest compliment. And it's also consistent, because the concept of organ meats permeates everything this book is doing. From the very beginning, there's a lot of graphic, unsettling imagery relating to bodies and bodily functions, but it's not there just to shock and discomfort the audience. It ties back into the dynamic between the two characters. Because when you think about it, the work that our organs do is unpalatable, it's unsightly, some might say it's undignified, but even if we don't like to think about the inner workings of our bodies, how our bodies cycle through waste and break things down, at the end of the day, we need those functions, those organs, to live. The same is true for these characters about each other. Their friendship is not this beautiful, easy, feel-good thing that's amazing to behold from the outside. But for all the things they put each other through, for all the things they've shared with each other, ranging from horrifically vulnerable to incredibly tender, they also need each other to live. On top of that, I feel like the story is just an aggressive rejection of traditional femininity and cis-heteropatriarchy. These characters are undeniably girls and women, but they're not soft, they're not dainty or delicate, they're not dignified, they're not palatable nor digestible, they're not negligible or easy to minimize, which is not to say that women are inherently all of those things either, but rather that's what society wants women to be. Society demands that women are submissive to the allocis heteropatriarchy, which also ties back into how the characters have this obsession with comporting themselves like dogs, because at least domesticated dogs are submissive to humans. From what they've inherited from their ancestors, what they've learned from their parents, that's what these characters believe womanhood to be. That's what they think they are destined for. So they're all at once kind of leaning into it way further than they should, and also rejecting those ideals and those modes of existence. It's just great, and it almost becomes Frankenstein-esque towards the end, which is very much my jam because Frankenstein is an inherently queer story. I don't have time to explain that, it just is. So that whole intentionality behind creating someone piece by piece and building up someone in a very purposeful way just hits all the right notes for me, and I loved it so much. And I said this to begin with, but the story is ultimately about connection. It's about clinging on to the things and people we care about and believe in most because we're afraid that the world is going to change them or change us, and we'll never get to have them exactly as we have them in this moment. But rather than giving into that fear and trying to force things to stay the same, we have to trust people and even trust the world to change and grow with us. There simply is no other way. And it's fucking terrifying, it's fucking grim, but that's life. So I'm still very much thinking through this, I'm still processing, there's so much I haven't touched on here. My gut rating right after finishing this was 4.5 stars. Do not ask me to explain that in this moment, but I am gonna sit on it and just don't be surprised if I later pronounce this to actually be 5 stars. So that's officially a wrap on Organ Meats. I did actually get a chance to read exactly 10 more pages of Behind You is the Sea during my lunch break today, but this will be the first full evening of me putting my full steam behind this. I did find out the audiobook is actually available on Everand, which I pay for and subscribe to myself, so I did download that just in case. I do think I'm gonna continue reading it physically for the moment, but in case I wanna like go on a walk or do some chores and get some multitasking done, it's just nice to have the audiobook on hand in case any of those things arise. So those are the Wednesday updates. I do have a reel to finish editing right now, and then I would like to go on a walk later if there's still some daylight when I'm finished, but we'll see what happens. Hopefully I'll have some more to share about Behind You is the Sea when I check in tomorrow. Hey babes, it's Thursday afternoon, and in a stunning turn of events, I am now somehow over halfway through Behind You is the Sea. Don't ask me how that happened. It just did. I say stunning because I would estimate I was maybe 5% of the way through when I last checked in, so really after just one evening of focusing in on this, I'm making pretty good progress. And as it turns out, I am in fact hybrid reading this one, so the audiobook has indeed come in clutch. I was able to go on my evening walk yesterday as planned, which was really nice, and I just had a bunch of chores to do after that, you know, changing the sheets, washing dishes, that kind of stuff. So anytime time my hands have been busy, I've been plugged into this. With all of that said, let's chat about my thoughts. I'll start with this. I'm enjoying it very much. And I will also say there's a lot of potentially triggering content in this one. Off the top of my head, I think I would name misogyny, death, grief, racism, xenophobia, and ableism as some of the top subjects being discussed. So if any of those things are dicey for you, definitely keep that in mind. This is gonna sound negative, but I promise you the point I'm trying to make is actually not negative. Even though I knew this novel was made up of interconnected stories going into it, I don't think I really understood what that meant. The official synopsis names these three families who are connected in this Palestinian community. So I figured the story would be bouncing back and forth between those characters from those different families, which it kind of is, but in practice, it's so much more expansive than just three families. Like, the connections between the characters are not delineated so cleanly or so easily, which is actually a good thing. Each chapter really and truly functions like its own short story, which I find fascinating. It's really working for me because we go through entire character arcs in each chapter. Every chapter has tension, conflict, suspense, rising action, climax, falling action. Each story is so incredibly self-contained, but at the same time, inextricably connected to the other stories. The fact that both of those things can be true is kind of wild. For me, that's made the reading experience so far incredibly dynamic. I get invested in each character's life, in each character's story, and then we see the so-called minor characters who are populating those stories get to have their own chapters later on, where we get to hear from their perspective and learn about the things they care about, what they see as their main focus, which might be aligned with what we've learned before, or it might be something completely different. So in all actuality, the book isn't giving us rotating points of view. It's not simply a story about three families, like I said, but rather this really intricate ecosystem of a Palestinian community that's so rich and so complex. Once we get a character's chapter, we don't hear from them again. The story doesn't circle back to their perspective. Their part, at least as a narrator, is over. They might appear again in someone else's chapter, but whatever story they've chosen to tell as their own is considered complete. And I know this is by far not the only book in the world that's ever used this kind of story structure, but I'm just saying that as a reader, I'm finding it to be incredibly effective. As for what the story is trying to accomplish thematically, I'm still thinking through that as I go. I do appreciate how the story strives to show each of these characters in the fullness of their humanity, as in showing what they've endured, what they've gone through, but also being unforgiving in showcasing their failings and their flaws. The one thing that unites each and every one of these characters so far is the fact that they are deeply, deeply imperfect. There are people conducting sexual affairs with their employers, people navigating broken marriages and relationships, people who are estranged from their families. And while the story isn't an endorsement of that behavior, it also isn't an indictment, which is a really important distinction to make. It makes me think about what I said when I talked about Against the Loveless World by Susan Abulhawa, which I feel like engages in a similar project of trying to show that being imperfect doesn't and can never possibly overshadow marginalized people's right to their dignity, the space they're allowed to take up, and most importantly, their existence. It's a distinctly Western way of thinking to demand that colonized people, marginalized people, indigenous people, people of color, people who are othered, must be unflawed in order to, quote unquote, deserve our attention, our care, or even our support. The right to live, the right to take up space, the right to dream and create a future for ourselves, and even the right to make mistakes is not something that has to be earned. And by firmly staking a flag in these characters' marrow-deep imperfections, the story is making an incredibly powerful statement in that regard. And of course, even though the story isn't directly addressing it outright, there's an unspoken underlying theme of grappling with the meaning of homeland. Obviously, there are emotional and psychological consequences of that reality, but how does that loss of a homeland, of a motherland, unconsciously haunt these characters? How does that lack of connection, that continuously opened and reopened wound branch out into their lives in other ways. And for the record, I am not saying I am correct in those interpretations. There's a lot of story left and it could go in a lot of different directions still, but those are just some of my initial thoughts and those are just some things that are running through my mind as I continue to read this. So I'm gonna keep going with it, of course. I would love to finish it before the weekend if possible so I can at least start my third and final book, but we'll see what happens. I'm just gonna keep chipping away at this and I will check in with you tomorrow. Hi friends, it is Friday, but this is not the official Friday update. It's just a really quick interlude for me to say that in regards to The Curse of Pietro Houdini, I want to officially say psych, fuck Derek B. Miller, I will not be reading this. I know I came in hot there, I'm gonna explain. Before I get into that, I do want to clarify that it has nothing to do with the story itself. Nothing about the actual text brought me to this conclusion. This could be a great book, it could very well be a book that I would have loved. We'll never know because I'm not going to read it. So I did crack this open last night just to say that I did, and also maybe to give you a little update when I did my check-in later today. And what I read was pretty good. And I honestly, genuinely can't explain what made me do this, but as I was reading, I was getting invested, I was getting intrigued, and I thought to myself, why don't I know who this author is? He's published like 6 other books, ostensibly also with Simon & Schuster, a Big Five publisher. It's weird that I've never heard of him before this. So I did look up his other books, which also led me to look up him, and I don't like what I found. I'm gonna put this down because her role in this story, in this video, is concluded. So the first thing I noticed was that the author, in terms of social media, was not on Instagram, but was on Twitter, which stood out to me because a lot of, let's say, well-adjusted authors usually have it the other way around because Twitter is ridiculously unsafe. So that was strange in and of itself, and then I actually started scrolling through this man's Twitter feed, and it was bad. He has been tweeting on a daily basis, sometimes multiple times a day, a lot about the Israeli occupation of Palestine, and it's very hard to parse where he stands. There are these little glimmers of pro-Palestine sentiments, and he does seem to believe in the necessity of a ceasefire, but he also, either knowingly or unknowingly, weaves in a lot of Zionist sentiments in his tweets. So it's the same talking points as people who call for a ceasefire but then qualify that by saying that no ceasefire can happen until Palestinians release Israeli hostages, when it should just be ceasefire, period, and free Palestine, period. Most concerningly to me, last Friday, which as I filmed this was International Women's Day, he quote retweeted some promotional video from the Israeli army, possibly the IDF, I'm not sure. It was just a video of a bunch of women from different branches of the IDF or the Israeli military saying who they are and what their position is, and he simply commented, "Happy International Women's Day." I don't feel the need to explain myself any further. Clearly, this person and I do not see eye to eye when it comes to matters of genocide, pretty big fucking deal, or the liberation of oppressed people from colonial imperialism, also a big fucking deal. And so I don't support someone like that, and he will not be platformed on my watch. Of course, I can't tell you who this man is. I can't make any proclamations about what he believes in. He is more than able to do that himself, as his Twitter feed proves, but we obviously do not align, and his work is not welcome in this space. So that's disappointing. Obviously, I did really want to read that book, but it's going to go back to my library unread, and I'm going to do what I do best, which is pivot. So every month, I make a list on my phone of books that I would like to hopefully get to during that month. Things that are most interesting to me, things that sound the most appealing, things that align with different projects or focuses I'm taking with me into that month. I don't consider it to be like a hard TBR because a lot of those titles get changed or swapped out depending on what I have time for, what I would like to read, what I have energy to read, what I have access to. But either way, I looked at my March list and went back to my library catalog to see if they had anything on that list. And they do actually have the audiobook For What Feasts at Night by T. Kingfisher. So I checked it out and we're gonna go ahead with this. Appropriately enough, I did listen to the audiobook of the first book, which is read by Avi Roque, one of my favorite narrators, the official voice of Cemetery Boys. I love Avi Roque. I think they did such a phenomenal job in the first book, and so I'm really excited to be able to listen to them again in What Feasts at Night. So that's pretty much everything. I just wanted to be fully transparent about that whole swap in, swap out situation and the rationale behind it. I am excited to move forward with this instead, and I also just wanted to put it on your radar because I might bring it up again later since I might have some time to start the audiobook during work as I multitask and do all that kind of stuff. So we'll see what happens, and if that's the case, I will talk about this later when I do an actual proper update. So I'll see you again after work. I'll just say it right off the bat. Did not get to any of What Feast at Night. I had the time, but I would have needed my wireless headphones to listen to it, and I couldn't find them for a better part of the day until like half an hour ago, so no progress here for the moment. I did, however, somewhat shocking myself again, finish Behind You is the Sea last night. Final thoughts, I enjoyed this very much. It was not only thoroughly entertaining and full of disastrously messy characters, but it was also striking and memorable in a lot of ways. Each individual chapter is so strong. Like I said before, they're all a very complete look at one moment in each of these characters' lives. But they're even stronger when you put them in conversation with each other, when you see how each story subtly builds upon and complicates what you've been learning about each community member through other people's eyes. So the structure of the story itself is almost a metaphorical nod to the experience of community, which is what these stories are really trying to emulate in a sense. Two of the stories I read last night were especially tough to read. One of them was about a woman whose father's dementia is getting progressively worse and worse. The other was about a young woman with body dysmorphia and internalized fat phobia, struggling with disordered eating and implied drug abuse. I just say that to once again remind anyone who's interested in picking this up that it's not easy to read at times. That doesn't mean those stories don't have power or that they should not be told. I'm just flagging that content if it is potentially triggering for you. I feel like another one of the big connecting threads between all of these stories, as different as they were, was the fact that all of the characters were missing a nurturing presence in their lives. Some had parents who had already passed or who were in the process of deteriorating or dying in some way. Some characters were estranged from their family. Some characters were disconnected physically or emotionally from their families. So for me, that's what kept bringing forth this idea of a lost motherland, a lost connection to something or someone that should be a guiding force, an anchor, a safe harbor to return to. And what happens when you don't have that? Obviously, when you think about it that way, the metaphor has a very clear connection to the Palestinian diaspora and refugee experience. I feel like that makes sense. Hopefully that's not too much of a stretch. Generally speaking, I feel like this was a pretty successful story. It's compelling, it's easy to get sucked into each individual person's story, the structure of it works really well. It's also incredibly satisfying, narratively speaking, because it begins with a character in the early stages of pregnancy and ends with a Palestinian funeral. So it feels like the two ends of that narrative circle touch. There are two things I want to make a note of. First, one of the characters is a cop, and I was hoping the story would go somewhere with that and actually explore the implications of that choice, especially concerning the cognitive dissonance it would take to be descended from people who left a military-occupied country to then willingly become a cop yourself. But the story just doesn't go there whatsoever. The other thing is there's a story about a mother whose son is on the spectrum, but he's labeled with a very outdated diagnosis. And even though that story is partially about her fighting against ableism on behalf of her child, I feel like it still perpetuated some ableist stereotypes in the process. So I just wanted more, and really I expected more from both of those stories in different respects that I just didn't get. Again, none of the characters in this book are perfect. They're all extremely messy and flawed. And while that does allow us to experience and witness more of their humanity, it does mean there's more room for possible oversights as well. Ultimately, while I do have those critiques, overall it doesn't take away from my appreciation of the story. I would definitely read more from this author in the future. I do think she has at least least one other book, so I'll have to look that up. But I feel like this was a solid 4 stars. That is my official Friday update, and what a day it was. Thanks for sticking with me. I think there's going to be at least one more update over the weekend to sort of wrap things up. I'm literally going to go downstairs right now and plug my ears into What Feast at Night, so wish me luck. Hello, happy Saturday, for me, not necessarily for you, and welcome to the end of the vlog. I'm having a pretty chill Saturday, you know, got some good sleep last night, finished the second half of What Feast at Night, which I'll talk about in a second, had some breakfast, got some sunshine, even though it's technically sunshine through the clouds, but you know, overall, I cannot complain. And by finishing this third book, I did officially complete this week's goal, which was to read down my library holds. I am now, at least for the moment, library hold free. We did it, kids. So now let's talk about What Feast at Night. I didn't say what this was about besides it being another horror novella by T. Kingfisher, so I'll do my best to give you a quick little synopsis. This is, like I said, the sequel to What Moves the Dead. It's the second novella in the Sworn Soldier series. I didn't know the series had a name, but apparently it does. We're once again following Alex Easton, who is trans and also a retired soldier, hence the name of the series. Alex's pronouns, by the way, are Ka and Khan. Ka is the standard pronoun and Khan is the possessive. Alex has just recovered from the whole ordeal at the Usher Manor, and now Ka is returning to Khan Family Hunting Lodge for some sunshine and some rest. But what Alex and Khan companions find is an empty lodge, which shouldn't happen because Alex's family hires people to caretake the grounds in their stead, and on top of that, no one is willing to become the new caretakers and stay with all of them at the lodge. Alex and Khan companions are sort of investigating around, and they start hearing the townsfolk reference old folktales about a breath-stealing creature who walks into people's dreams at night. I really enjoyed this, which is absolutely no surprise. I love T. Kingfisher. I find her brand of horror to be delightful, which I know is a very strange descriptor of the genre, and incredibly compelling. She always manages to execute types of horror stories that you would not expect. I like that she seems to be giving us different flavors of horror as the series progresses. I really hope there's going to be more books in the series, by the way, so I could be proven correct in that prediction. The first book is much more gothic in its stylings and its trappings. Obviously, it's a Poe retelling, so it has to at least sort of follow a similar trajectory to that. This second book, though, is not a retelling, so there's a lot more freedom for T. Kingfisher to explore Alex's character, especially. In terms of the aesthetic, this story is much more of a folk horror story. It's very much built up around folklore and superstition, and because it's more about the mythology of this specific place, that really lends itself to the atmosphere of the story. I also really dig how the setting of the story sort of parallels the monster the characters are dealing with. It feels almost claustrophobic, very isolated at times, because the characters are confined to the grounds of this lodge, and because the other townsfolk are so fearful of this folkloric creature, no one is coming to help them either. No pun intended, but it's a very sleepy kind of horror story, which again I think is very purposeful considering the monster at the center of this narrative. So it kind of creeps up on you. The first half is mostly speculation, investigation, and suspicion, and the back half is where everything just goes to shit. The other thing that really stood out to me is how this second book spends a lot more time exploring Easton's past experiences with war and trauma that stems from that, as well as Khan's diagnosis of tinnitus, which is an auditory condition sometimes related to hearing loss. I so respect how Kingfisher weaves both Alex's PTSD and Khan's into the haunting at the center of this story. It all feels connected, and as Alex is confronting this folk monster that may or may not be haunting this lodge, it feels like Ka is also being given a chance to confront Khan past and process the reality of how war has undoubtedly shaped so much of Khan life. T. Kingfisher is also doing some really neat stuff with like dream magic, dream walking in this story that I think is really fucking cool. I'm not going to talk about it because I don't want to spoil anything, but I will also say that it creates a very satisfying narrative that makes the story feel like it comes full circle in a sense. Listen, I'm still very much in the processing stage, but long story short, T. Kingfisher has done it again. She can do no wrong in my eyes. I had a great time with this. The audiobook is spectacular. Avi Roque did some incredible work once again. I just really hope we get more Alex Easton stories in the future, and I think I would give this 4.5 stars. So yeah, that brings us to the end. Thanks for following along with my reading adventures this week. Even though you're seeing this after the fact, thank you for motivating me to read down my library holds. All in all, I feel like it was a pretty good reading week. I'm going to be starting A Dead Djinn in Cairo after this, so look forward to hearing my thoughts on that at some point. But besides that, I hope you've enjoyed. Feel free to head down to the comments and let me know what you've been reading these days. Thank you for watching, stay safe, and I'll see you next time. Bye!